And we are live here at the Mo Summit with Simon Mainwaring, the founder and CEO of We First, all made possible by Big Path Capital, the leading impact investment bank that assists in company exits, capital raises, and founder liquidity. Simon Mainwaring, what brings you to the Mo Summit?
Firstly, I'm just thrilled that We First is included in the Real Leaders 100. And probably the most exciting thing is what's unique about this event is it marries impact and growth to show that it's truly possible. So everyone on the list has demonstrated, you know, disproportionate growth and disproportionate impact. And I think that really proves out the case for how business can be afforded. So to meet other CEOs and leaders like that is inspiring and proves that it can be done.
When you say business as a force for good,
right,
what do you mean by that?
I mean that you can actually unlock this synergy between driving business growth as a function of the positive impact that you have, and that in turn, that positive impact is actually a further growth engine for the company. So it used to be that polarity was reversed, where it used to be that we would make products or make money, and if we had something left over at the end, then that could be applied to philanthropy or whatever it might be. Nowadays, it's actually reversed in the sense that you lead by doing good. By doing good, you earn the goodwill of your employees, of your consumers, of your customers, and that in turn drives growth for the business. And so it's a very, very powerful dynamic and one we're very familiar with, but it's reversed.
So businesses that are not considered as business force for good, you kind of work with them to tell their stories. Can you explain how
Sure.
you do that?
Well, you know, We First is a creative consultancy that drives growth for purpose-driven brands. So obviously a lot of the clients that come to us will say, we don't know what to say or how to say it, what our purpose is, what is our positioning in the marketplace, you know, what is the story we should tell? And then secondly, they'll say, well, how do we build a culture around that? How do we make sure our employees understand what we stand for? So it unlocks their full productivity, their satisfaction, you attract the talent you want, you keep them longer and so on. And then finally, the third piece is, well, how do you tell that story? So what's the creative advertising, marketing work that needs to be done so that your customers or consumers know that? So, you know, it depends on the challenge that a company has. We work with founders and startups, we work with large, complex global organizations, but in all cases, the common denominator is how to unlock the value to the business of the good work that they're doing.
And could you tell our audience like a story about a company that you've worked with?
Sure, there's so many companies that are interesting. I'll share a startup that we worked with. We have a client that was Nova Austral, which is a Chilean salmon maker, producer. And they were coming to the US market and they wanted to launch for the first time. And without oversimplifying it, the salmon market is complex in the sense that Alaskan and Norwegian salmon are sort of premium in terms of quality and price and so on. And Chilean salmon as a category had faced certain challenges. So how do you shift the optics in and around that? And we decided strategically to do something different, which is that Nova Austral is the southernmost salmon producer in the world. Mm-hmm. And so we decided to create a whole new category of salmon called pure Antarctic salmon. So rather than take on the Norwegian, Alaskan versus Chilean debate, let's define the battle that we want to fight. And we created this new category around pure Antarctic salmon. And we defined the brand, its whole brand identity, launched it as 60 South, which is the latitude in which they actually produce the salmon. And, you know, they now have huge retail distribution across the world. And their retailers have said it's the easiest story they've ever had to tell because all the visual cues of what it looks like to be in the Antarctic speak to the quality of the product. It's like making salmon in Mother Nature's deep freeze. And so by being very strategic about how you frame the brand and then leveraging these assets that are unique to them, what they do from an aquaculture point of view, from a positive impact point of view, has really made an enormous difference to their business and driven their growth. So just one example of how you can think about what to say and how to say it in a way that is authentic to the difference you're making but drives growth as well.
And so how does that new brand identity unlock productivity you mentioned earlier?
Well, it unlocks productivity internally with employees because I think one of the greatest challenges for any company these days is how to win the talent wars. So you want to attract the talent that you want to have, you want to keep them longer, you want to get their full productivity out, and then you want to, you know, inspire them to reach out to others to join the company or be effective advocates for the brand. And so sometimes we forget that human capital we invest in every day, that line item on your P&L, payroll, is in fact fleshware. It's people. They've got a spirit and a heart and a mind, and they want to do work that's meaningful. So this purpose work is so incredibly valuable into getting the most and highest selves out of the employees that come in your door every day. And I think that's probably the most overlooked area in terms of unlocking value for your business. Then there's the marketing and the community impact work that you're doing, but the employees and the culture you build is incredibly valuable as well.
And what aspect of a company's brand identity do they struggle with the most?
You know, I think brand identity takes many forms. There is the language you use. There are the values that inform how you behave and show up in the world. There is the logos and style guides and color palettes that companies use. And I think it's not any one of those things, although individually they're very important. It's the consistency between them all. So I would challenge any brand out there, purposeful or not, to take out one ad that is representative of how they've shown up in the world in the last year, and then take all of them across the board and put them up. Whether it's Facebook ads, whether it's collateral sales materials, whether it's advertising they've done, whether it's the homepage of their website, put it all up at once and say, does this look like a singular, coherent brand that has a clearly defined and unique and differentiated point of view? Or does it look like you're saying lots of different things in different ways on different channels, and effectively you're broadcasting your schizophrenia at everybody? And this is especially true for younger companies because understandably, you're focused on getting your product to market, your MVP, and raising funds, and then raising the next round of funds. And what typically we've found working with startups and high growth companies is that after a few years, you look back and go, well, we've said all these different things about different products at different times. How do we connect the dots? So we come in and do that higher order soul for the brand that allows you to align everything underneath it. And then we bring that to life through their culture and then through all their advertising and marketing. And then when you start to behave like a sophisticated brand, customers or consumers look at you, and just as a function of how clear you are as to who you are, they assume that your products are better. There's more trust, implied on the brand. And that's, again, another way that you drive growth.
Simon, you have a ton of experience in Sure. this area. Where does this come from, and how did we first begin?
I spent 18 years as an advertising guy in Australia, London, and the US. I was a writer on Nike at Wieden & Kennedy, their ad agency. I was worldwide creative director for Motorola. So my big epiphany was, a certain point in my career, I think like a lot of us question why we're doing what we do, and is it fulfilling or satisfying? And I was in my late 30s with two young kids. And I thought, well, what would be more fulfilling would be to take the power of storytelling that I learned from working on brands like Nike and bringing that to bear on businesses that are having a positive impact. And so I wrote a book about this called We First, that it was a New York Times bestseller, and that launched the company 8 years ago. And since then, we've been lucky enough to work with a lot of the purpose leaders like Toms and Virgin Unite and Clif Bar and Timberland and many others, as well as startups and very large complex organizations like SAP and Sony and VF and others. And what you get at from all of that is you get the pattern recognition around what works across the board to drive growth through purpose. You also get a deep understanding of the challenges you face at different stages of growth. So when you're a startup, you don't have a line of sight as to what's going to happen when you reach 100 employees. Or if you're a high growth company, you don't have a line of sight as to what the challenge might be when you're going into new markets around the world. But because we've worked for very large companies and very small companies, we can not only help them navigate in a forward sense, but we can also help them falls. And ultimately, our mission is to help business become a force for good. And I think one of the big things that we've noticed that is overlooked is the role and power of storytelling in doing that, in driving growth for companies that are making a meaningful difference. And that's a gap that we're sort of honored to play a small part in filling. So that's what we're about.
ReLeaders Magazine, how does leadership play a role in your brand identity?
Leadership is very interesting today, and by that I assume you mean like the SLT, the senior leadership
yes.
team, the CEO, the founder, because leadership is a broader topic. But that being the case, there's now an expectation or an onus on everyone in a leadership capacity to be a spokesperson for the brand. So you can't hide behind the boardroom or the press release or the job title anymore. You've got to be out there and in your personal life and in your professional capacity be a representation of what the brand stands for. And that may take the form of just showing up in a certain way internally at the company. It may take the form of, industry events and speaking on panels and forums and so on. But even above and beyond that, a big change to the nature of leadership is that brands need to transcend their products, their category, their services to shape culture. In which case, brands need to speak to issues that are larger than what they do, that are larger than their industry. So you see, it might be the Howard Schultz's of the world at Starbucks talking about racism, or it might be, you know, Patagonia talking about access to public lands. You're seeing these brands be very proactive and, you know, public facing about their point of view. They're an extension of the values of the company and its employees. And so I think leadership has changed in the sense that on a personal level, you've got to get very clear about who you are, what you stand for, and how your own personal sense of purpose informs the company. You've got to be much more vocal and public and be an effective spokesperson for the company. And then you've really got to rise to the challenge of not just launching new products or services or leading your industry, but really shaping culture in a larger sense. And when you do that, that's when you show up in people's minds as being truly relevant and meaningful to their lives. And they go, you know what? Consciously or not, I want to buy your product because I like what you stand for in the world, or I heard something that you said, or as opposed to other brands that aren't really clear about what they stand for, at least you have a point of view and I want to see that future enabled. That's when you drive growth again as a leader.
Simon, for viewers watching this,
sure.
What is the most important thing they should know about their brand identity, or that they should do for their brand identity?
I think, you know, I come to the table through the lens of storytelling and marketing, and with a view to how does that drive growth, which is what every company wants. And I think if I had to distill down one fundamental shift that would make all the difference in the world, no matter what category you're in, how young or, you know, established your company is that you need to shift from being the celebrity of your stakeholder community to being its chief celebrant. And what do I mean? Even the most purposeful companies, many of them make the mistake of talking about the good work they're doing in a self-directed way. So, this is what we stand for, or this is the number of hours our employees have volunteered, or this is the donations we've made. And ultimately, a lot of that falls on deaf ears because you're really talking about yourself. And that, you know, we all know from all the data and research out there that consumers, citizens don't want to be advertised that. They don't want to be sold that. They don't trust advertising. No one wants more ads in their Facebook feed or Twitter stream. Instead, what you've got to do is reframe your messaging as the celebrant, where you demonstrate consistently what's that higher order thing that you're of service to. Mm-hmm. So you would talk about, instead of telling the employees what the company's about, you would share what the company's about and then celebrate those employees who are bringing it to life. Shine the spotlight on them, not always the company itself. When you're talking to customers, you wouldn't always sell yourself to the customers, but rather you would be a collaborator with those customers and celebrate the impact that the customers are having out in their marketplace. And that creates a halo effect around your brand, and customers want to work with you more. When it comes to consumers, you know, they don't want to be told how fabulous you are. They want to know what you stand for, so you're relevant and meaningful to their life. So it gives your products badge value, so they want to have your products and buy your products. And then you celebrate the impact that you're having on their lives or on the lives of others through your community impact or giving or philanthropic work. And so it's this shift from being self-directed to being community focused. And if you do that, you'll unlock the power of being purposeful, because you'll demonstrate your commitment to something higher than yourself. That will be meaningful and relevant to all your stakeholders' lives, from suppliers to employees to customers to consumers. And if your messaging's framed around that, then people are interested, because it's just as much about them as it is about the company, and they'll be much more likely to share it, and that will drive growth for your business. So you need to shift from being the celebrity to the celebrant of everyone in your community.
And sometimes finding your purpose is a little difficult.
Sure.
It might take some self-reflection. What do you do for self-reflection to get your mind off of things?
We define purpose in a very strategic way that falls out of the book We First and the 8 years of practice that we've been doing. So it's not so much a case of reflection as it is a process that we've road tested with top purposeful companies out there, very large complex organizations with lots of executives to kind of align, as well as startups or founders who are a little bit too close to see. And the truth is, it's hard to define your own purpose, because it's hard to read the label from inside the jar. You know, you're there and you're like, what is it? I can't see it. I'm living and breathing it every day, but I can't see it. It's right there. And, you know, we had this wonderful experience with Tom's, where we were brought in to define their purpose, and I was CMO in there for a few months, interim CMO as part of the project. And, you know, everything you do, whether it's a one-for-one model, is an expression of something. And the way we arrive at this conclusion, and I'll come back to the solution with Tom's, but we ask a series of questions, and I'll give a few of those questions. And the point of these questions is to externalize yourself, to get yourself outside of yourself, as opposed to this outside echo chamber that goes outside the jar that goes on inside your head. And so one of those questions is, what are you the only of? So what are you the only of? There's no one else with your team. There's no one else with your journey to that point in your company or in products and services. There's no one else in that market with that team with those products at that time. So what are you the only of? The second question, which is very powerful, is if you can't define what you're for, let's start with what you're against. So what are you the only of? What is your enemy? And so in my case, we first was started because after the global economic meltdown in 2007, 2008, I was really upset about the me first informing business, and that led to a lot of challenges, as we all know. And so what was the counterpoint to that? It was a we first mentality where you prioritize the interests of the collective first. So that was the enemy in my case. When we were actually working with Tom's and Blake and the team, I actually asked Blake at one point, we were in a brand council meeting, why did you start the company? And Blake paused and he said, well, I didn't want to start a company. I just wanted to get some shoes on that kid's feet. And in that moment, I realized that the enemy of Tom's wasn't bare feet. The enemy of Tom's was apathy, the idea that there's nothing you can do to solve these large and seemingly intractable problems. And in all cases, every brand has an enemy that you can kind of readily identify that will help you then flip it and see, well, on the other side, what do we want to change in the world? And then the third question is, when you're at your best, what are you doing? When you're having that day where you're high-fiving with if you're a solopreneur, you're high-fiving yourself in the mirror. But when you're at your best, what are you doing? And if we start to answer a series of questions like this, what are you the only of? What is your enemy? When you're at your best, what are you doing? You start to externalize yourself and see themes emerge. And it's a much larger process to this. But, in 8 years of doing this for all manner of brands, we've never had a situation where we haven't been able to distill that down. And in the case of Tom's, ultimately, it was to create a world in which we live for one another. And why is that important? Well, you buy one product and another's given. But employees and leadership are there for one another. Employees in the US and around the world are there for one another. The private sector and public sector are there for one another. The way of being that Tom's owns, of living in the world, is living for one another. And that's a very, and Blake was so thrilled, he actually got it tattooed on his left bicep, for one another. So it's there forever. But all of that is to say that it's a process of reflection, but it's a very strategic process, and it's all about externalizing what you know to be true, but you're too close to see it,
Exactly. And Simon, it sounds like a very interesting book. Where can our viewers find it?
We First is on Amazon and all those other great things. We First, how brands and consumers use social media to build a better world. We First is at wefirstbranding.com. And we've also, there's a lot of young entrepreneurs that quite understandably don't have the resources to get the type of expert support they want. So what we did was we took all of our learning from our clients, as well as we spoke to folks, the head of environmental initiatives at Patagonia, Rick Ridgway, the head of strategy at Tom's, Jordan, Linda Weinman, the founder of lynda.com, and we went through the whole process with them, and they are all on the training platforms as well. And so we have the training platform called wefirstworks.com, wefirstworks.com. You go there, and there's two courses there that are very inexpensive that will allow young companies with limited resources to get all this expertise and input so they can succeed. Because it doesn't matter how good your company or your product is, if you don't know how to tell that story well, you'll either fail or you'll never get the growth that you deserve. And we are now at this moment in time where we need these companies to succeed. We need them to be the new normal of business for all the reasons we all understand. And so we're just trying to do everything we can to, whether you're small, medium, or large, provide the support so that you get the power of the business and the power of the products, but also the power of the storytelling to go to scale, to reinvent business.
Simon, appreciate your time here on the show today.
No problem.
Folks, go online at wefirstworks.com. You can learn more, unlock your potential, find your brand identity, and buy that book that Simon was talking about today. So thanks for tuning in to the Real Leaders Podcast and the Real Leaders Show here at Live from the Mo Summit, brought to you by Big Path Capital. Simon, thanks for coming on the show again.
Thanks so much. Thanks.
We'll be right back.